unless you're going to be very disappointed, I'm going to tell you now, we don't have any cabalistic charms here to sell. We don't have any special bits of abracadabra which are going to transform this room into a swimming pool or anything like that. But what we do have is we have the four unique and special minds of people who spend their time making artworks. And what we're going to explore through individual presentations from each of them is the way in which they think about their practice, how they make their practice, and how the creative process is unique to them, but also is in dialogue with the world around them. And I'm going to then explore some other questions which I think are, I suppose, critical to the ways in which artists are making work now, which is different to the ways they might have been making 5 years ago, 50 years ago, 500 years ago. By the time we get back to 500 years ago, we are back onto that magical threshold. But in this present moment, let's think about the magic in a light, a sort of animal magic kind of way. So we're going to have a series of presentations by each of the artists. You'll be able to ask them questions, but we'll try and save most of the questions for after each of the artists has done their presentation. So we're going to go in alphabetical order. So first we have Rut Blees Luxemburg.
Hi.
The artists are also going to introduce themselves.
Yeah, so I'm Rut Blees Luxemburg. I work with photography, and I thought I'd show you a recent project I've done in London. And because this project will illustrate very clearly how my creative process works, I hope. So, Silver Forest Magic. I was invited by an architect to make a public artwork in London, in Westminster. Now, you know London, Westminster, Victoria Street, it's in the center, it's very close to many important landmarks, such as the river, Houses of Parliament, Buckingham Palace over there, the cathedrals, Victoria Station, also a very important hub for people who come to the UK for the first time. So I was asked to think about an artwork for that location, and this is the location. It's Westminster City Hall, so it's a civic building, it's the council. It's an important building in terms of they're responsible for planning permissions, maybe even weddings.
Weddings, I'm sure.
Yes. So it has an important civic function. And it's in this crucial center of London. And yet Victoria Street, for those who know it, is a very ugly street. It was rebuilt after the war. It has all these office blocks. It's super polluted, and now it's being rebuilt. And as we all know, the transformation of London is kind of hardcore. So, anyway, so this is the site. It's very large, and it's quite a challenge for an artist to think about a public space like this, which is so visible, and to think about a work which will be there for a while, which even has the ambition to be permanent. So how can I, as an artist, contribute to this place, but also engage very deeply what London is at the moment, and what this particular place is? So I looked to painting. And this, I think, is quite important for an artist, is to be in dialogue with other art forms, be it the cinema, be it philosophy, be it literature. So for me, in this case, a painting by Paolo Uccello, a Renaissance painter, Italian, who painted this wonderful small painting called The Hunt in the Forest. And what drew me to this painting is the perspective. This was a very important painting in terms of developing the notion of perspective. And what we have here, although it's a hunt, we imagine something very violent, very bloodthirsty. No, we have something actually very civic. We have the prince going out there with his people. If we don't see any blood, we don't see any violence. you see a ritual, you see a civic ritual, and the hunt was used as an allegory for courtship, for love, for meeting the beloved. Courtship and the hunt have a strange relationship. Very interesting to me, because I'm thinking about the city, the public space, also in terms of encountering the other. This is in Beijing, in China, where I went in 2011. And as you can see, there's a similar perspective as in the Renaissance painting. And this is a man-made, human-made forest. Beijing, the most polluted city, closely followed by London in the world. Yet this forest in the city manages to survive. This to me is very interesting, to bring the magic of the forest and the forest that teaches us something about survival, about refuge, finding repose. So this was then my proposal. I create a forest, a representation of a forest on this side. I bring the forest to Victoria Street, which is a bit like Macbeth bringing the forest. So bringing the forest to the facade, and not just the forest from Beijing, but also the forest from London, the silver birch forests we find in London. Here it is. You see the scale, the humans are small. The forest is so much larger than them. It becomes an imaginary space. You're no longer in the real forest, you're in the forest of your fantasy imagination. And this is how it was made. And I'm showing you this. These are the panels. So there were... the photographs were scanned and cast in concrete. This is a new technology, and I think it's for artists, it's very interesting to work with manufacturers. I don't make this, I work with other people who are capable of making this. And so there's a type of dialogue. I learn from them, they learn from me maybe, and I can utilize their skills. So I rely as an artist not just on the architects who make the site or the city planners who allow me to put the work up. I also rely on the people who put the work up, the manufacturers. So there's a very important dialogue going on between many people. So art, although it starts from the person, ultimately quite often involves many people. Here you see the installation. Oops. And this is how it looked. This is the finished work. The silver forest. Now there's one element of this work which I want to draw your attention to, because I think it's very important. When I made the proposal, I thought I have to not just show them a forest. There has to be the magic object. There has to be the one thing that is usually hidden, but that, like the hunt, in a way, is an allegory and speaks about something else, something that we don't speak about because we can't really speak about it because we're all involved in it. So there is this object, oh, there you can see someone touching it, that I inserted. So when I photographed the forest in London, I inserted this sack. It's a heavy sack full of sand, which you see all over London at the moment. And we have all these building sites, and everywhere are these huge sacks. Have you noticed them? They're everywhere, but they're invisible, strangely. But now that I told you about it, you will notice them. They are in black, white plastic, sometimes even hemp. And these sacks, to me, are a sort of stubborn resistance to what's happening at the moment. Because the sack has an allegorical meaning. It speaks maybe of the gift, Santa Claus, but it also speaks of the crime, the robbery, the daylight robbery. And there, for me, that is really important to show that something isn't quite right. And that's all perhaps that I could do, but it was important for me to insert the sack to show my resistance. So I think that's me.
Fantastic.
Okay.
So if you have a pen or a digital device and you'd like to write yourself some notes about questions, that would be fantastic. And you can ask them later, or indeed you could just tweet them, and then maybe someone else will answer them in the interview.
So I started at St. Martin's from 94 to 98. And this was the digital and communications revolution. So I wanted to somehow respond to that. And my way of capturing some material of that is to use the stock listings of the Financial Times as the background of my work. And initially, I started out as an abstract artist. And then I began to become a more figurative artist after leaving the Royal College in 2001. And I did a residency at the Chinese Art Center, but this was just after a residency in Pakistan. And when I did that residency in Pakistan, I was talking to all these artists, and I realized that they knew all of these artists that I could talk about from Europe and America, and but then they'd also be able to talk to me about subcontinental African, Far Eastern artists, and I realized that my art world that I'd gone through and experienced through art school was an extremely limited one. And so after that residency, I was able to give myself all sorts of permission to do the type of work that you see in this studio at the Chinese Center, Center for Art. And it was actually on this residency that then I got into the British Art Show. And around this time, the financial crisis had happened, so I was trying to respond to that as well. And so what you see in this painting is the I think it was the 9 too big to fail banks that actually collapsed in a matter of 2 weeks. And it was in that time as well that the headline was saying it's the end of capitalism. And so there's always been this interest in waves of apocalypse. So from 94 to 98, there was this utopic euphoria about what the digital communications revolution was going to enable us, you know, of all of us joining hands, borders and boundaries that were dropping. And what we had was actually, pretty soon after that, was tech stock crash, millennium bug, 2001, Enron, WorldCom collapsed, and 9/11, the terror attack, the war on terror, and all of this before the financial crash of 2008. So a lot of my work has been trying to understand some of the mechanisms of why these sorts of things happen. And it led me to looking at how the first financial bubble happened, which was over tulips, the sales of tulips over about 370 years ago. And then that led me to looking at the Dutch Golden Age, which is the birth of modern capitalism, with the rise of East India Trade Company. And so I started looking at, I have to jump across first, looking at Dutch Golden Age still lives. And because of the motif of the tulips in there, so at the peak they were selling for the price of a house. And the Dutch Golden Age, what I became interested in was also the rise of how civilizations rise. And the Dutch Golden Age, of course, was built on slavery, colonization, and militarized trade routes. But of course, you wouldn't see that in the type of paintings that the Dutch Golden Age would celebrate and elevate. And so I was interested in this kind of erasure of history while elevating certain narratives over others, this kind of unknowing of knowns, which was the sort of title of my last show. And so, you know, you have all these sort of incredibly luxurious sort of objects, usually in these still lives, and what they don't ever reveal is the obviously how they've been accrued, how they've actually been sort of as a civilization sort of gathered. So rather than it, well, it is also about the transience of beauty, which is this romantic language, the futility of materialism and the fragility of mortality. But of course, it has this sort of darker undertone as well. And what I do to these high-resolution photographs of these oil paintings is I use an algorithm to reorder the pixels. And this code, by reorganizing those pixels, I think of it as a metaphor for revisionism and repetition of histories. And this is a painting on the last show called Great Wall of Sand. And so from moving from the Dutch Golden Age as a birth of modern capitalism to modern day capitalism in China with this communist capitalism, which maybe a decade ago we would have thought this is impossible, you know, capitalism only exists hand in hand with democracy, and yet China has blown this out of the water. And so what's happening in the South China Sea at the moment with the build-up of artificial islands is this kind of new drawing of geopolitical lines and where potentially new hot and cold wars will be fought. And so the floating islands that you can see there are the seven sort of artificial islands that have been built. And this allows China to claim 200 nautical miles as sovereign territory. Underneath it is the map that's being used to justify this claim, called the Nine Dash Map, and it was published in 1949. It's not very clear as to what it's actually claiming. Previously, before 1990, they said that in all the islands within that area is actually ours. But then after 1990, when an oil businessman came to the Chinese government and said there's oil and gas reserves under that sea, maybe you should use that map to claim that entire region, and they started to change their rhetoric, and now they're claiming the entire territory, and redrawing narratives to make that claim. In the distance is the constellation map, or what looks like a constellation map, is of the new Silk Road being proposed by China. And the two mountains that you see, a little bit like storm clouds, are Mount Sinai on the left and Mount Song on the right, these two holy mountains of two different civilizations. And so it's dealing with all these different histories of the rise and falls of civilizations. And in this particular painting, you have a past, present, and a future map of the situation around the South China Sea.
Apologies for my voice. Usually, this, of course. So, thanks to our Image and to DACS for inviting me to talk as part of this event. I recently actually joined Artimage, and I've been a member of DACS for quite some time, and I'm sure we'll talk about the importance of copyright and licensing as we sort of move through this event. So in the next few minutes, I'm going to show some of my work, which looks in the main at the impact of the emerging digital world on identity formation. And in this area, I've worked mainly with the young people, actually from the introduction of computers into education in the early 90s onwards. So really, I've been looking at those people that have been perhaps the most profoundly affected by the changes stemming from the early introduction of computers into education. And in the context of this really short presentation, the theme of magic, or the conjuring up of illusions that break with the everyday, can be read, I think, through the computer and the emerging internet at that period in history, whose early reception had very clear links to photography and perceptions of the magical. So this is a very early piece, actually, 1997, that I produced working with a local primary school in Edinburgh. I had been in London and then working on a Henry Moore Research Fellowship, working with the then newly sort of arrived computer and art education, and wanted to do something about the then kind of nascent sort of rise of digital technologies for children. And I decided to sort of start working with the earliest, so children of 4 or 5, primary one, very young children who were learning basic programming and BBC microcomputers, So I went in very simply, photographing children as they, their computers were wheeled in. They were doing these classes, and then they were moving out. This to me was very fascinating. And you know, if you talk about the theme of magic, you know, for me, at that point in time, the possibilities offered up by sort of the graphical internet, which really only came online in 1993, were very, very exciting and could really be described as quite magical. And I continued actually to work with schools and was very interested actually in every iteration of technology as they moved through from tethered computers, modems, through to wireless computers, iPads, handheld gaming devices. Every time that something new filtered into the education system, I would go and work with local school children, local schools, and try and photograph when I can things that were happening. So I really, you know, worked with not only computer education, but also became very interested in the way that drama and art figured, or increasingly doesn't figure, in sort of early years education, and had good access actually to sort of documenting various kind of sort of workshops, creative classes with children. This is a series of portraits called The Robot Workshop, which is very straightforward. I was also working on a project on robotics and AI, and it just so happened that parallel to that project, which was shot all over the world, my local school was also doing their own project in robotics. So I went in and would document that. Computer gaming is something that has always really, really interested me. I'm really sort of looking at the texture of play for children in terms of sort of the digital world, how that changed the way that they played, the way they thought, the way that they formed their own sort of identities. This image comes from a larger project which was film and photography called The Skater, which was part of a commission for the photo gallery in Wales. And for that project, I began working with a group of adolescents. So these subjects, these teenagers, or sort of like early 20s, had actually been children in the same, so they were, you know, they'd been the same age as those that I pictured in computer class when I first started photographing digital interaction in school. So in other words, digital natives who'd grown to adulthood surrounded by the computer. It was interesting because I started to work with this group first and found out, so I thought that was interesting and really wanted to make still images that were very much like freeze frames of computer games. And this is something I had a brief discussion about, the power of photography and how now photography has become, I think, even more of a challenge and quite exciting to pull people in front of the still image, because we're so used to sort of moving image content. But for me, sort of anything up and down about, because in the summer of last year, class as a whole, and I'd worked with this group on quite a few occasions over the years, mainly looking at the impact of the computer and digital culture had on their lives. So last summer, again quite recent, location-based gaming had exploded onto the scene. And it seemed that much of that group's time outside school was spent chasing Pokemon around the streets of the city. So using GPS and camera functions, they seemed to roam around inhabiting two worlds at the same time, one geographic and one imaginary. And I really wanted to capture that dual existence, again, in photography, you know, in still photography. So for these portraits, I used a sort of fractal generator of the type used to create, you know, 3D objects for digital games. To produce a random algorithm that's embedded into individual portraits of the class. So that's basically all I'm going to show you today. I think it's, you know, it's interesting to look back and, you know, we've been working quite a while now, quite a long time. So I look at you and I say that we're talking about sort of the 90s. And it is really nice to be able to see a kind of arc, you know, we're talking about sort of themes repeating, so coming back again. So that's certainly something that I enjoy in my creative practice.
So when we were asked to talk about how to create magic, I kind of took it quite literally, and I thought about the magic that's in my work and the transformation of my work. But I also I thought about the magic Yeah, so the transformation and the magic that happens within my technique. I'm afraid I also thought about the disappearance of my brain, so you'll have to excuse my notes. How to create magic is kind of the perfect question for me. I think my work, I think of it as magic. So I thought I would tell you why, and I thought I would tell you the story of my practice. I've always been excited by things that were unconventional, unaverage, and uncommon. And my artwork has always looked at these kind of processes. I met a tutor in my first year at university studying textile design who spotted it. He watched me create surface patterns from my veins. He watched me create surface patterns from roadmaps. He watched as I turned a Morris Minor into a catwalk collection. And then he suggested I take a look at discarded textiles. So I jumped fences behind the recycling bins of local supermarkets and scrambled through banks, down banks by streams at the side of roads, and filled black bin bag after black bin bag with rotting clothes and took them home to clean. I'm still not quite sure that's exactly what he meant, but that's what I did. When you clean fabrics that have rotted to rags, you discover a beautiful delicacy to them, an eerie lace-like aesthetic whose threads captured my heart at university and have kept me captivated ever since. The Japanese aesthetic of wabi-sabi is loosely translated as the appreciation of things that are weathered by time and nature, a beauty that is imperfect, impermanent, and incomplete. A perfect aesthetic to describe my beautiful rags. A few years later, after I had graduated and had murdered many washing machines, I took an artist in residency in a school, which was where I began to paint, trying to convey how I resonated with these garments. The residency gave me 2 years to solidify my practice and explore what I wanted to say. I started to spuddle, to experiment with different inky mediums, and found myself feeling like an alchemist, obsessed by the excitement of creating reactions. The slightly dizzy feelings from the fumes and stumbling out of my studio that had been affectionately termed the dungeon by the school at random times of day or night added to an increasing image of the mad artist scientist, which seemed to fit well, especially with my frizzy hair. I'm not sure the school really knew what they'd let themselves in for, and it was definitely an interesting challenge asking teenage girls to find beauty in rotten, thrown-away dresses from Primark. But my aim was to find something that represented the fibres of the garments, something that conveyed the beauty within the eerie solitude of the cleaned lace-like remains. I wanted to find a way of magically transforming something that others had discarded, something deemed disgusting and lacking in any aesthetic quality, and bring it back to life, giving thrown-away fashion a beauty that it had never had before. I began experimenting with streams of consciousness, and I had so much I wanted to say, so much I was interested in, so much I wanted to explore. Maybe it was the fumes affecting my brain. Whatever it was, I wrote and wrote and wrote in words that joined up to become indistinguishable, tangled threads all over my canvases. Over time, a technique began to evolve. I'm about to show it to you. It evolved from the reactions of the inks, creating spidery effects that again resembled the threads in the garments. And I found something extremely exciting that I wanted to work with. So because of the inky technique, my work is fluid and it flows. The streams of ink battle and react with each other. And I've pretty much, absolutely, no control over it whatsoever. It's terrifying, it's thrilling, and it's an extraordinary way to work, especially when it comes to demanding clients and commissions. I've worked in the pipeline that is over 9 metres long. It will need to be painted in situ, which is again terrifying and thrilling and a huge adrenaline rush. Will it go wrong? Well, of course it'll go wrong, and I'll have to explain that to the client. It'll probably go wrong a few times, but that's also part of my creative process, that, the fear and the sleepless nights. So the secrets that the technique still holds is for me what keeps me going, keeps me hooked and obsessed with what will be created at the end of each piece. The fact that even though I've been working in this way for years, it still doesn't show me until the very last moment what a finished painting will look like. So the Oxford Dictionary defines magic as the power of apparently influencing events by using mysterious or supernatural forces. My interest lies in the process behind the work, in its mysterious forces that create aesthetically interesting paintings. Some of its secrets I do know and will carry with me to the grave. Some are mysteries even to me, but I guess that's how I create magic. That's it.
Fantastic. So, the context for this conversation has to be said. It's also that we're in the fringe of D&AD Festival. And that sense that maybe one of the conversations is about this the freedom of the process. When you're an artist, maybe when you're not necessarily working to a brief, maybe within the design context, there's a sense that someone is actually giving you a specific brief. And I think that just listening to you there, Beth, the sense that even if you might be working on a commission, you're still actually, you're refusing that brief. You're refusing the absolute definition of someone else telling you what to do. And is that absolutely essential to your sense of why you're doing what you're doing?
Yeah, absolutely. I have clients that come to me and suggest different colours or where they want or different compositions within the work. But I mean, it's actually quite difficult to do that because the work works. The work produces itself. I'm just a vessel, really. So.
But it's also interesting that what you're saying in terms of the work producing itself, and the material in some senses seems to have chosen itself as well, but it's not in isolation. It's come out of this trajectory of development of dealing with a material, a type of material which you found fascinating. So when at the point at which this work is, do you imagine that this work will transition to something different?
Yeah, absolutely.
So, and are you aware of the horizon when that might happen?
No, I wish I was.
Yeah, so because I think that I think that the previous work I know of yours is very much is located in a dialogue with architecture. So in some senses, the magic forest is no surprise.
Well, I would actually take issue with your idea of freedom.
Okay.
Because I think it's not working on a commission is actually not freedom. It's the opposite. It's more of a responsibility. Because it's easier if you're given a commission and told what to do, but if you are, as an artist, you have to take complete responsibility for your work. So maybe that is a freedom, but it's a freedom which comes with a huge onus.
Mm. Wouldn't you think so?
Yes, I mean, I think that's absolutely right. I mean, I think that successful commissions are ones, perhaps, that pick up on themes, like I think yours did, that you're clearly I've been working on developing, thinking about the real resonance in these ideas that you're exploring in this particular commission, that you have other iterations in other bodies of work route. You know, and I think that's the best kind of commission. And certainly, you know, I found that with them, the skater. You know, these are ideas that clearly are like with your idea of the magical forest, or being explored in different kind of ways, and then the commissioner comes in. You can think, oh, that's an opportunity to extend and develop and sort of push that idea. So you know, it's a double-edged sword, really. Of course, it's great to get commissions, but they have to be commissions, I think, that develop the ideas in an interesting way.
And they have to be commissioned by people that understand your work. I think that's the other thing. So that you're not battling with the client at times.
But don't you see that being an artist is a battle?
Yes,
in some way. What do you think?
Yeah. But in relationship to your body of work and the sense of the evolution of the practice that defines itself in relationship to photography and architecture, this work is perhaps not a shock. So, but at the same time, it's a massive transition for you, as you say, in terms of this sense of the transition in the process. So in terms of the kind of the freedom you're allowing yourself is actually this freedom which says, no, someone else will do this fabrication. And is that sense of the proximity to the creative process and the relationship to its materialization, how do you feel that as an artist and its importance? In a simple sense, is that artist's hand still important to you or not?
No, I think it's really important to be able to go beyond one's established practice. I started with photography, I started with the 5.4 camera, I love the print, but I think I have to be open to let other ideas and practices and way of doing things enter me. We all have to. You know, we had at one point we had to accept that we do things on the computer. It's the same as an artist. You have to let all these other ways of expressing yourself become part of your practice. I mean, you were a pioneer in working digitally.
Mm. Yeah, I mean, it's really interesting because, I mean, now I'm working mainly on like an iPad, and it's sort of much more low-res sort of imagery, which is carried and shown and distributed in a very, very different way. And that's something else we can talk about as well, I think. But it's a peculiar thing about photography, because I think in photography, sometimes photographers do get very, very wedded to equipment, you know, and they become, I don't understand why, you know, they become really attached to camera. But I think the best artists working with photography are actually ones who will pick up whatever they need to use to make that work, whether it's a camera or I don't know, a hammer. And I think that, you know, younger photographers are working much more in that way anyway, moving between sculpture and photography. So yes, I think that there's been massive kind of sort of like transitions, all really healthy actually in photography in the last sort of 10, 15 years.
In terms of that dialogue with technology and tradition, I mean, in your practice, is there a sense that you're talking to a generation which is more visually aware? So when you're having a conversation about the composition of these portraits, with these fragmented layerings, is that something that they conceptually understand while you're thinking this?
Yeah, I mean, that is really interesting. That's something that I am actually thinking about quite a lot, is the way that people receive the works in very different ways depending on their own relationship to that technology. And that's something I really did think about actually beginning of this year when Kirsty had asked me to do this project in adolescence. I did have a kind of ambivalence about it, because I thought, well, you know, adolescence is a period of life that is characterised more than any other by the image, by the photographic image. And all teenagers have many more sort of photographs of themselves in their pocket than any of us. So perhaps they are the best person to represent themselves. So I think you've got to keep sort of questioning yourself, I think, in terms of your subject, but also in terms of the media and strategies that you use.
But it's also interesting in terms of the question of fixity of subject. I suppose in some senses in the history of photography and portraiture, we imagine that still photography, like a painting, will fix you, and that will be the... And now we're in a much more sort of transitory notion of subjectivity, and that seems to be picked up again with the use of the title of avatar within some of this work.
Yeah, I mean, I think that for me, the introduction of the internet, the advent of the internet, that hadn't happened, I really would not really have had a career as an artist, because it allowed me not only to make the work, but also to have people see the work. Because at the time when I was first making it, nobody was really interested, for quite a long time. So, you know, I think that the technology is kind of massive impact.
And do you think that the children you're working with, in that sense, have a sense of you know, the magic of what it is you've done with them? Do you think they feel you might be doing something different to what they're doing?
I really don't know, because it's like, you know, I do see sort of children making the most extraordinary images, self-images, themselves. You know, so I think, what could I possibly hope to give them? That they can't do so much better themselves. So I don't know, that's not really for me to answer that. History will tell, or not.
So, to Gordon, I mean, I don't suppose you're really expecting that there's going to be a strong convergence in terms of the question of allegory in this discussion, but obviously in relationship to magic, allegory would be all important, and that's why magic probably got into all of those dialogues around paintings, because it was this occult fringe where an artist could come in and compete with other theologies in terms of their capacity to play with the universe. But that does seem to be quite, you know, when I'm thinking about your work, and there's a layering immediately, some sort of strange intuitive layering that you had around your work, that it was going to be initially in dialogue with the financial marketplace, and that you would be everything you do would be built in dialogue around this fundamental sense that your canvas would be based in this other narrative. So can you just talk about that moment when you decided to do that and why it was? Because it seems very fundamental.
It was the digital communications revolution with the rise of the internet and availability of mobile phone technology. And there was all these ideas about the perceptions of time and space collapsing into the instant. And this, for me, was a really interesting space in flux. And why I'm drawn to that sort of space, I suppose, is because I have grown up with things like home computers, and I still play computer games. You know, so my interaction with the screen was very different. I remember that moment where the television used to be this thing which projected images out. And as soon as I played a computer game, it was these really rubbish 8-bit sort of, well, they were fantastic for me at the time, but this notion that you can control the pixels, however fictional and delusional that might be, within the fixed parameters of the code, for me was this revelation. You know, it was like, wow, this electronic space is this incredible new landscape, you know. And so when I got to art school and there was this revolution, these revolutions going on, I wanted to find a way to capture it, and that for me was the stop listening to the Financial Times, this information space carving out these virtual spaces of trillions moving in an instant, defining utopias and dystopias. And so I used that material to paint with, like my pigment, and I translated the principles of painting by exchanging the brush for technology and my paint for the stuff of the everyday that was traversing fields.
And was that an easy transition for you to make? So, seeing the technique of your painting, evidently there's an incredible sort of dexterity there, which is, you know.
Oh, it's been over many years. Yeah. I mean, you know, so initially I painted without paint. You know, so I was an abstract artist. It was more conceptually sort of based, and then through the decades, it's become more figurative and involved more mythological narratives, and in recent times, actual geopolitical sort of histories, and it's all kind of rooted, I suppose, in my identity of being both British and Chinese, and this idea of being in between, and so this virtual space was one that I was easily drawn to, you know, this you know, compounded also by my relationship to the TV, I suppose. You know, it's such a huge part, you know, of my life. I've stared at it for so much of my life. You know, using computers and stuff like that is very natural, you know, to me.
So the other question in terms of magic is, I suppose, is a question of magic and possession. And from each of you, I'd like to hear what do you actually think the thing is that you do in terms of capturing someone's attention, which is different to that flow, which we're obviously immersed in. So Beth, can you capture that? Do you think?
I'm not sure I can. Well, I think a lot of the time with my work, people don't understand the concept behind, and it's actually not something that I keep it quite to myself. And that, I mean, I'm obviously quite a secretive person, and that gets brought out in my work. So people don't necessarily know what's behind my work. I keep that story quite closely guarded.
But it is something that people have been captivated in, on social media, on Pinterest, etc.
Yeah.
People have, there's
so I think
things.
They're captivated by the aesthetic. That's the thing about my work. My work's very aesthetic based.
And I mean,
the concept is
the bit
that keeps me going.
It's been very difficult for me. Well, the magic in the work is, I think when one makes art, one has to be super perceptive. You have to be very intuitive. You have to be open, incredibly open to all these forces surrounding us. and hopefully you'll be able to sort of track some of it down, or the work is able to capture some of it. So I think the most important thing is to be, for me, as an artist, to try to have this openness, this perceptiveness, so that that is the magical moment, this fundamental openness. And also try not to be judgmental. So the work has to be in this open sphere.
In that sense, there's a kind of, there's a gift, a magical exchange, so there's a possibility for someone to take your images in all sorts of ways.
Not necessarily. No. That's in the I'm talking about the making, and I think that is different to if I was a commercial designer, where I wouldn't have that radical openness. But that radical openness, and we talked about it at the beginning, is not necessarily... It's not all just wonderful and fantastic freedom. It's also it's a work, and it's tough to have that. It's not that, you have to sort of allow that. And I'm also an educator. I work with students, so this is something that's one has to work towards.
Sort of a bounded gift. There's boundaries around the gift.
I don't know, not necessarily boundaries, but the ability to let it happen and let it affect you.
But do you think, I mean, so I'm probably thinking about some of the images from Dakar, but do you think that the sense of the sort of mediumship in some of your images is quite a strong? There is.
You mean the photography?
Yes, yes.
Well, for me, photography is this wonderful medium which actually is capable of letting it happen. I have very long exposure, so the camera is open for 10, 15 minutes, so things do happen. Chance can happen in that time,
And I suppose in that, that's
and that's why it's similar to you, there's the element of chance and things.
And this kind of in the flow, there is a kind of commitment to observing the flow and trying to shape the flow of what is happening.
Yeah, being at the time where, and being at those places which are perhaps, for me, I think they are important, but they're not noticed, of they're dismissed quite often. It's the hinterland of the city.
So, Wendy, just thinking about, in terms of an artist's body of work, there are works which are works, and they're finished, and they have titles, and they're sold, and collected. So, in terms of the magic, how do you decide when something is unmagical? Is that a difficult process?
No. It's very easy to see when something's unmagical. I remember the first time that, going way back, I remember the first time I started actually to work with children. And it's quite interesting because I wanted to do a project on identity formation and to use a computer. This was like, you know, early 90s, and I couldn't find, I wanted to work with a group of amateur actors, couldn't find any group, and all I could find was a group of, this goes back to what Ruth was saying about chance, was groups of children. It's like, at that point, I was like, children? God no. You know, never worked with children. As soon as I put the tripod up, as soon as I looked at the camera, I just absolutely knew that this was the perfect foil to begin to explore this whole arc, which lasted 25 years, of how our lives were going to be irrevocably changed by sort of the coming digital revolution. So it's just very fortunate. But then it goes back to what Ruth was saying about being open. You know, and I think that, again, you're talking about teaching, and I just come out of a very kind of like theory-intensive MA at Goldsmiths. So I've been reading all my Donna Haraway, you know, I've been reading all my Rosanna Luckworth Stone. Very excited about these ideas that were locked in theory, explored in theory at that point, but not visually. You know, and I do think that for me it's very, very unusual to meet an artist whose work you really love and not to find them just incredibly interesting and sort of like well read and know exactly what's going on. So that's the magic. You know, the magic comes from looking around you and being very aware of your position within that sort of global kind of conversation of whatever it is you're looking at.
But just in terms of the spells which don't work,
right.
How do you decide that?
You've got to have lots of spells that don't work because you know, you produce, you've got studios full of crap.
Yeah.
We all have, you know, real rubbish. You know, well,
some of it.
You know, all of us. But what I'm saying is it's a long and quite often circuitous and painful process. It can take years. You can work with ideas, can't you, Gordon? And then think, oh, and then park it, and then 5 years later go back to it, and suddenly it comes to life, and that's the magic. You know, but you know, this goes back to the whole kind of point of DACS. It's having the support, you know, whether that's financial, emotional, physical, or whatever, to be able to keep going, because it's a long-term game, you know.
Yeah, and I suppose that is an obvious question that we would be interested in talking about here. I suppose is that in the sense of, as artists creating this magic and something which is totally captivating and that people find, you know, seductive, immersive, transformative, you know, what does it then feel like when you're kind of cut out of the chain of remuneration and no longer are rewarded for your work? I mean, is that something that's happened to any of you or all of you?
I think you've got to be able to ride these inevitable kind of dips and troughs. I mean, you know, hopefully you're making work, but it's personal inquiry. You're making it because you have to make it to survive. It's part of who you are. In my experience, artists do it to remain sane. Mm. You know, it's very much so. Yeah, I mean, these things happen, but you know.
My work's been stolen extensively this year, this last 2 years, and put on the back of iPhone covers and the back of laptops, naked out of skins and all over the place. I was in Bangkok at Christmas and came across one of my iPhone covers, and it's quite, I mean, DACS have really helped me to deal with copyright issues, and it's quite a thing to have your work stolen. What I think is fascinating, though, is that it was brought to my attention from artists. So artists see your work in a place they don't think your work's going to be, or they have seen my work and come to me, and I haven't, obviously, because it's been stolen, I haven't had any remuneration. So for me, DACS has been massively helpful with copyright issues.
But it's interesting, that sense also that doesn't disincentivize you to carry on making work, mm-hmm. the sense that someone has inappropriately used it. You have to somehow create that in a different compartment to the what actually drives you to keep making the work. What about you? Have you been appropriate?
Yes, I've been copied and whatever, but you know, at the same time, we also participate in a bigger global conversation, and it's a tricky one. It's a real tricky one, because great art often references, collects, collages, other work. So it's a difficult one.
You're feeling okay in the circulation of magic at the moment?
I feel I can handle it, yes. It's okay. But it's also, you know, if one does something that is so beyond what could be appropriated, which is so disruptive, disturbing, then one is kind of safe.
That's a challenge to any artist or designer thing. You've got to create the armature.
You have to go so far beyond that they don't even.
Nobody understands it.
they could not use it for their own gains yet.
Yeah.
That's interesting, because you know, people do copy your work, you know. People just to copy ideas clearly do, especially if they're good ones. But they're very rarely more successful than the original. You know, there's often this like strange kind of sort of reflection of that happens and has happened since the birth of photography.
But it is something, actually, I think you're right, that artists actually are particularly attentive to that. And artists are more slighted than the general public. When they see an artist they know's work being, you know, ripped off, I think that they do. They're uncomfortable about it. But, I mean, Gordon, going back to this kind of transition from your painting to using the digital algorithms, how do you think that makes you vulnerable to people manipulating or impersonating that style?
go for it.
Yeah.
It's taken me years to get to that point. Yeah, and also I'm completely committed to what I'm doing, so I challenge them to be equally committed.
Yeah.
You know, if that's what they want to do. I mean, it's the same for any of us.
Because you're prepared to actually go into dialogue with the work and the body of your work, and that's the underlying knowledge base which gives your work value.
It's so much. It's like what we've been talking about. The creative process involves every fibre of our being, and our relationship to our histories, our world, and our inner sense, our philosophies, our psychologies, and so on. You know, so for anyone to try and sort of copy that, for sure they can copy it aesthetically from a very shallow sort of point of view. But in terms of like creating a stream of work, you know, then good luck.
I think that's a fantastic challenge. So, can I throw it out to the audience now? If anyone out there has a question, an aspect of magic that so far we haven't addressed. Silence has a magic all of its own. Okay, well I'm gonna continue because I do actually have more questions, and it actually goes a little bit. I'd like to explore actually a little bit more about this kind of question about allegory, in fact, because I'm interested in how you feel the question of narrative in your works is still relevant, and what we think about narrative in the relationship to visual works. It seems like there's a story that's happening, and how we imagine that. So how does the element of thinking about these allegories, how do you contain that? Do you write any notes about the system, or is it just up here?
I've recently started, because most of my shows are solo exhibitions, and I like to create a show with works in dialogue with each other. So I usually try to map out by drawing a diagram of all the ideas and how they're interlinked, and then you can feel where the most interesting concentrations of, say, creativity are, or what you might call magic. And that's where I will develop a particular strain of work, and then that feeds onto into another work that is in dialogue with that. But even when you're making your work in the studio, for me in the studio, you're thinking about the future work. It becomes like this sort of topology of epiphanies.
But are you recording? I mean, you are recording them because they're in the work.
Yes.
But are you displacing that recording anywhere else? Is what I'm kind of curious.
I draw these kind of big maps,
and they're kept.
And notebooks, I suppose. Yeah. You know, or on my iPhone, the notes. Like on the back of my sketchbook, I'll have titles or something, and each of those titles are obviously a chain of thoughts. You know, about 99% of them get used. But when I look through it, I'm thinking, oh, that's what I was thinking about. And all the little notes that you're taking or that you're writing down. Even looking back at your shows. You know, what you did back then to what you now, or how you understand it now as well, and how that then feeds into another show.
And is that the same for you, Andy? I mean, are you creating... And you've worked in film as well, I know, so that, I assume, has kind of storyboards. But are you creating storyboards and narratives around each of the work that you record?
If there's a book for the project, which I was with the skater, then I do. That's a great way to do it. Of course, there aren't always books with every project. I mean, to talk a little bit about allegory, I was interested, because Ruth, was that you, cello? You used as a sort of springboard, you know, to produce your lovely sort of piece, and allegory has always been popular in photography. I mean, it's come and gone, but it's back. I did think about that a bit, because with the skater, with the avatar, I also was looking an awful, and I have said, but done since I was six, Henry Raeburn's Reverend Walker, which is emblematic painting of sort of enlightenment in Scotland, which is, you know, a 1760s a painting of this tiny painting of this tiny black clothes reverend, a couple of hovering on this expanse of ice. So that was a reference point for me. But I think things can be quite oblique, you know, and you can't necessarily put them in language. You know, they just sort of filter into the consciousness. And this thing about using paintings, I think that, I don't know how you feel about this, but there's just so much, so many references, lots of possible references out there. Sometimes you just want to go into a gallery to just be stilled, or a museum, or in my case, and just to allow you just to sort of anchor yourself. And I think that, for me, that's why I haven't gone back to the museum, the object of the painting, because otherwise the world's just too chaotic.
There's so many narratives, aren't there? Narratives that we don't intend or that aren't in our control as well. So there's narratives that we build within the works. There's narratives that we that drive us to make those works. And then, of course, there's a narrative of the artworks belonging to a history as well that we don't have control over, who elevates those narratives and so on. So it's so so many multiple strains, you know, in which to think about or not to think about. You know.
But I suppose the kind of one of the I suppose one of the con- I suppose one of the considerations around allegory is that it folds in these kind of barbs within it. There's a layer of decorative construction, and then there's this information which is secreted in it in a kind of occult sense. And I think that from an artistic point of view, I think that's interesting. That there, in some senses, going back to your idea of defence, there is actually a necessity to internally create these mechanisms which protect the work and articulate it fully at a level which isn't on the surface. And that certainly seems when with your reworking of the painting, with this bag that comes in there, and it's an object which is easy to ignore and yet is not possible to ignore. And in that kind of consideration of it, you put the viewer at a dis-ease, but you also allow them to go somewhere which, if it was just trees, they possibly couldn't go. And that's a kind of, it's a tactical strategy.
Absolutely.
Yeah. And it seems absolutely essential to the work. And I suppose, and also, I suppose, for your work, that thinking about taking another tradition, the Wabi Sabi, in this sense of that, if not an allegory, it's certainly, it's a set of rules around an ascetic practice, which is very, very ancient and would be, you know, it's developed over time. And certainly, you know, within Japanese culture, that's something very, very particular. And again, it's a layer of information which is just not necessarily there or obvious. But from an artist's point of view, it's a kind of another layer of discipline, if you like. Again, I learning some spells. At which point, I think we will adjourn to the easy magic of alcohol and chat. But I'd really like to thank my panel. I learned a lot more, so that's great. Thank you. Thank you very much.